I will talk to you on accreditation of engineering programs. The presentation which I am going to give you is basically has been prepared by NBA, National Board of Accreditation. So I thought nothing can be best than their presentation. So I will present that their slides only. Now, first of all, let us see what is accreditation. Accreditation is basically certification. Certification by a third party. So it is basically a formal recognition of the quality of an educational program institution by an external independent agency on the basis of impartial assessment, on the basis of a well-defined criteria. So there are few keywords in it. One is, if you see educational program oblique institution, either a program is accredited or an institution is accredited by an external independent agency. That means it has to be an independent agency like NBA, National Board of Accreditation, earlier was a part of AICTE. AICTE is an approving authority which gives approval to the technical institution. So it was thought that accreditation agency has to be an independent agency. So accreditation agency, NBA has now been made an independent agency registered under Societies Act. Impartial assessment based on the basis of well-defined criteria. That means the criteria is defined and it is known to the institute on the basis of what we are going to be assessed and accredited. It is not that I can have my own assessment criteria, or the evaluator who comes to your institute can have his own criteria. It is a well-defined, it is well-documented, which is available on the NBA site, which has to be followed. So it gives an idea to the institute also, what are the points on which they will be assessed. That is well-defined and documented criteria on which institute is assessed. Now, why accreditation? You see, one is approval, which we know it, that all the technical institutions have to be approved by AICTE, but accreditation is beyond approval. Because when we go for approval, AICTE sees the minimum requirement as per the norms of AICTE for starting a new program, for running it already, for increase in seats, for increase in the number of programs, they see the minimum requirement. But accreditation is basically, once you have established the institute, and it is presumed that you have gone through the establishment, initial problems have been taken care of, and you have reached some quality level, minimum quality levels, which can be assessed by accreditation board or accrediting agency. And once you have those standards, once you have reached that quality level, you are given a certificate that, okay, you have that minimum standard of teaching learning process, labs, library, faculty, so that you can produce a quality student. Now, at national level, students, parents, and parents to select the institution and program for admission. You see, there are a number of institutions available to the students now. If an institution is accredited by an accredited agency, the students will have an idea, parents will have an idea that, okay, this is the institute which has minimum required standards in teaching learning process. This is the institute which has equipment, which has well-developed labs, which has proper classroom, which has proper quality, faculty. So they have the choice and they can decide that, okay, this is a institute which has been graded, which has been accredited by a independent agency, so we can go to that institution, my ward, or I can take admission in that institution because I have a choice. Number of institutions are many now. There are universities, there are institutes, there are deemed universities, there are state universities, like that. So the student now has a choice, and he has the some criteria, some parameters on which he can select the institution to which he or she wants to go. Now it helps the employers in deciding about the institutions for recruitment of graduates. Naturally, if an employer wants to go to some institution for campus placement, let's say, or for their recruitment process, if the employer knows that such and such institution has been accredited by a independent agency which has some laid down standards and the institution meets those standards, the employer would like to go to that institution for placement, or they would like to have students from that institution for placement. If you many of us, because all of us are from technical institutions, if you see that Tata Consultancy Services, TCS, comes to the institutions for campus placement. Now, before they start coming to your organization for placements, they accredit the institute. Their accreditation team will come to your institute and see whether the institute has the minimum facilities required as per their norms. Unless you are accredited as per their standards, Tata TCS doesn't take the students from that institute. Institutions to avail benefits from regulatory bodies and funding agencies and institutions. That means if an institution wants to apply for some financial benefits under some projects, let's say you want to apply to AICT for some grant, MODROPS, RPS, there are many, many schemes which are available in AICT where AICT funds the institutions, gives money to the institution for improvement of the institution. The requirement is that the institute should be accredited. Unless you are accredited, your application will not be entertained. So that means it is an added benefit. Similarly, you must have seen in the papers, about 2 months back, there was a news that UGC has made it mandatory if any engineering, any college wants to apply for any grant from the UGC, it must be accredited. So unless you are accredited, unless you are certified to have minimum standard, you cannot apply for any financial grant from national or international level agencies. A very important aspect is at international level, mobility of students for pursuing higher studies and employment in other countries. If your institute is accredited and you are a member of the association of countries which are accepting each other's students. Now at this stage, if our student go to Canada and USA after doing degree, engineering degree, they are not accepted. They have to pass some examination there because their degree is not accepted as equivalent to their engineering degree. They call it as, okay, you have to pass PE examination, professional engineer examination. So if we become that member of that consortium where Canada and USA are also the members, then our degree will be accepted automatically. So one is for going for higher studies, you are eligible for going to other institutions, and within the program, let's say you have completed 2 years, now you want to shift to some other institutions. If your institution is accredited and your each other, there's a mutual acceptance of the credits earned, because two institutions are accredited, then they can transfer their students from one institute to other institute. So that is the biggest advantage, that students' mobility is there. Once the process has been certified, teaching learning process has been certified, then students get quality education and better employment opportunities, because everybody knows that such and such institution has proper processes, proper labs, proper faculty in place who can impart proper instruction so that the students passing out are of good quality, they can perform. Alumni share their experience and participate in curriculum updates in view of emerging technology and tools. You see, as a part of NBA accreditation process, you have to have alumni association and you have to have regular meetings of the alumni association, and in between there is a regular interaction, either physical or virtual through email, etc., with the alumni. So they can contribute. They can tell us, the institute, that okay, see, this is what you have taught us, but this is what the industry wants. So you can identify the gaps and you can give inputs to your students accordingly so that they are enriched and they are more employable. You can improve your processes. Development of faculty benefits of realization of efforts, opportunity of attempting more complex problems, career advancement, consultancy, and sponsored R&D. Once you know it, that your institute is accredited, then you can get some more R&D projects, sponsored projects. You can get more sponsored projects and it can result in more consultancy, better career prospects for the faculty, exchange of views, opportunities, supplement each other's requirement, because there are regular meetings with the parents, with the employers, with the alumni. So you get the views of all those and you can supplement your processes with the feedback. Employer in industry, academic, public services get well-grounded practice of engineers with requisite technical and behavior skills and graduate attributes. That means if the processes are okay, the outcome will also be okay. So employers who are feeling that what you are producing is not usable. You see, the general complaint is that what we are producing in the institutions is not usable in the industry. So if you are following the processes which ensure proper outcome, which ensure that your curricula is regularly updated, your processes are regularly changed to meet the requirements of the industry, requirements of the industry in terms of the graduates. So they'll get better students whom very little training will be required to be given, so that they are directly start contributing to the industry. Institution builds up a brand. You must have seen people give it on their websites also. They say NBA accredited. So that is a brand. That is a value which comes to the institute. Continuous improvement towards excellence in accreditation process, which is being followed by NBA now. There is a lot of stress on continuous improvement. Can you stop this, please? There's a lot of noise coming. So continuous improvement will result once you are working on the for attaining excellence in all our fields. Graduates from our accredited program is educational passport for engineers' mobility across good number of advanced nations and emerging economies. We have discussed this. These graduates may get leadership positions and challenging technology development opportunities. Faculty may get invitation for lectures. Jodhpur. TTC Jodhpur, please switch off your mic. TTC Jodhpur, please switch off your mic. DTC Jodhpur.
Yes, sir.
Please switch off your mic. Industry can hire graduates from accredited institutions for innovation intensive projects for higher profits, because they know that the students have gone through such a grind that their processes in place, so they can go to that institution where they feel the students will be good. Multinational accords in mutual recognition of accrediting process and thereby recognizing the accreditation. There are many accords which I was telling that you should be a member of that accord for mutual acceptance of the standards and student community. There is a Washington Accord 1989. That is for UG engineering degree programs. I'll come to it. Sydney Accord 2001 for engineering diploma and polytechnic programs. Dublin Accord 2002 for engineering technician programs. Seoul Accord 2008 for professional engineers in computing and IT related fields. Now these are just the names. Washington Accord doesn't have anything to do with Washington. The only thing is that accord was signing in Washington. Similarly, Sydney Accord was signed in Sydney. Dublin Accord was signed in Dublin, and Seoul Accord was signed in Seoul. That is all. That is, meeting was held there and Accord was signed there. In 1989, Washington Accord was signed between six countries: Australia, Canada, Ireland, New Zealand, United Kingdom and United States in 1989. The purpose was to mutually recognize and accept the qualification accredited by signatories. That means these six countries started an accord, they signed an accord and accepted that, okay, we will accept each other's qualifications, because they are supposed to have the same processes, similar processes and similar standards of education. At present, it has 15 full signatories and 5 provisional signatories, and India is one of the 5 provisional signatories. Members of the Washington Accord have outcome-based accreditation. I'll come to what is outcome-based accreditation. All members accept the defined graduate attributes. So, all the members have a common agenda that, okay, all engineering graduates should have some, they call it as A to K graduate attributes. I'll come to it also. Just wait. Washington Accord is applicable only for UG engineering programs. And if India wants to reap the benefits of its large human resource and to become knowledge society and global supplier of trained HR, it is must to be full signatory of Washington Accord, so that our engineers can go and work in other countries where there is a lot of demand for engineering graduates. As of now, many countries are not accepting our qualification. So instead of being a provisional signatory, we have to be a full signatory to that Washington Accord. Now these are the countries which are full members, permanent members, full signatories. There are Australia, Canada, China, Hong Kong, China, Chinese Taipei, Ireland, Japan, Korea, Malaysia, New Zealand, Singapore, South Africa, Turkey, United Kingdom and United States, through their bodies. Let's say USA is represented by Accreditation Board for Engineering and Technology. That is called ABET. That is one of the oldest bodies which we are trying to adopt their recommendations only. What they are following, we are trying to follow their processes only. Similarly, let's say Singapore. Singapore is represented by Institution of Engineers Singapore. So these are the permanent signatories to that accord. And these are the provisional members of Washington Accord. Bangladesh, represented through Accreditation for Engineering and Technical Education, Board of Accreditation for Engineering and Technical Education. German, India is represented through National Board of Accreditation. And Pakistan, Russia, and Sri Lanka. So what we are trying to do is, India is trying to do is, to become a permanent member of the Washington Accord, so that our engineers are accepted globally. While at least this, 21 countries who are permanent and provisional members. Now, what are the issues? Issues are that whosoever becomes, let's say NBI is representing India in Washington Accord, so that signatory should be autonomous. So we have made NBI autonomous. NBA is not under the control of anybody else. It is an autonomous body of government of India, registered under Societies Act. Transparency to accreditation system. That means the system should be transparent. People should know. I should be able to award marks to me, myself, so that I know where I stand. Before I call NBA for accreditation, the process should be known to me, so that I can grant marks, I can give marks to myself, to my institute, and see where I stand. And if I feel I am weak at some places, I should improve before I go to NBA for accreditation. Free from government and other influences, NBA is free from all these things because it is independent body, constitutional body. Basic educational program, entry, that means entry level qualification is seen. That means what is the entry level qualification? We also have plus two. Other people should also have the same. That is, 12 years of schooling should be the entry level. Then only programs will be of the equal level. number of years of the program. It is 4 years program. So others should have, because we can equate our 4 years program with the 4 year program of other countries if it is only after 12 years of schooling. Recognition of the program by competent accreditation authority and reputation of the institute. Obstacles, differences in education system, accreditation system, disciplines. We have many disciplines. Maybe there are countries which have very specific disciplines. We have mechanical engineering. Maybe other countries have thermal engineering, production engineering, right? Manufacturing engineering, like that. So there are differences how to equate them. That is also a problem. Now, who does it? Who does accreditation? In India, National Assessment and Accreditation Council, that is called NAAC, N-A-A-C. It is an autonomous body established by UGC in 1994 with headquarters in Bangalore. Now, if you see the first line, institutional accreditation. NAAC will accredit the institute as a whole, university as a whole, right? Whereas for technical programs, National Board of Accreditation is the body which accredits the programs. It doesn't accredit the institute. That means I am running five degree programs, five BTech programs or BE programs. Now I can ask NBA, I can request NBA, I can apply to NBA that, okay, I want to get my mechanical engineering programs only accredited. So NBA will give a certificate that, okay, mechanical engineering programs of this institute, mechanical engineering BTech program of this institute is accredited. Let me be very clear here. Mechanical engineering department may be running more than one program. Mechanical engineering department may be running BE in mechanical engineering, BE in auto engineering, automobile engineering, or ME in thermal engineering, ME in production engineering. So the program which has been offered for accreditation, only that is assessed, right, by the evaluating team. That is only that is evaluated. If I want that my mechanical engineering ME program should be accredited, only that part is assessed, nothing else. And you are certified. NBA will give a certificate only for that part, that okay, ME in manufacturing technology of NITTR Chandigarh is accredited. Now NITTR is running six other programs in masters. So they are not accredited if you are not applied. And NITR as a whole is not accredited. NITR only mechanical engineering, manufacturing technology program, master's program is accredited. So that is the certificate which is given. If somebody is using the certificate, somebody is saying that, okay, my institute is accredited, technical institution, there is nothing called institutional accreditation in engineering programs. If you are going through a NAAC, go ahead. It is. And AAC can give you a institutional accreditation, but NBA will not give you institutional accreditation. It will give you a program-wise accreditation, not even department-wise. So it is program-wise accreditation, which is given by NBA. So National Board of Accreditation gives diploma level to postgraduate level in engineering, technology, management, architecture, pharmacy, hospitality, and mass communication. These are the areas covered by NBA. Now, this is the process which has been followed. The latest, NBA has been following different performers, different formats for evaluation purposes. Now, the latest which has been made applicable from 1st April 2013 is the fifth revision, which is now available on the NBA website, which is, they call it as outcome based. That means, what are we producing? Outcome based. What is the outcome of the program? That is more relevant. What are the objectives? And have we achieved those objectives? I wanted that my mechanical engineering student will be a very good top mechanical engineering student. When he passes out, he will be a very good mechanical engineer. Now, how do I measure it? Are the proper measurement tools there? Are their measurements defined? Out-
outcomes defined? What are the outcomes? How we'll measure whether it is a top class engineer or not? So basically, the stress is on outcome here. Earlier, what was, if the processes are in place, labs are there, faculty is there, teaching learning process is there, we say okay. It was the process based earlier. Now it is outcome based. Stress is on outcome. I'll come to it. So earlier we were following this input output model, often involving direct prescription of curriculum and faculty composition. That means curriculum is there, faculty is there, we say the process and the teaching learning process is there. It was based on that. Now outcome model is focuses on the objectives and outcome of the program. What are the objectives and what are the expected outcomes? Whether these are being achieved, how do we measure these outcomes? Right? Requires evidence of measurement and attainment of objectives and outcomes. Too much data may be collected and analyzed periodically. That means you need to have a documented record of what we are saying. If I say my pass percentage has increased from 90 to 95%, I have the record. What are the efforts I have made? Did I take extra classes? Did I have remedial classes for the weak students? Right? Did I call some experts from outside to give lectures on the parts on which are not mentioned in the curriculum document, because industry needs it. Industry needs engineers with cloud computing background now. Now my syllabus doesn't have in computer science. Cloud computing is not mentioned there. Did I call any experts from outside so that my students can make up? They are exposed to what industry wants, right? So this is one model. What are the inputs? Financial resources, lab equipment, infrastructure facilities, faculty, number and quality of students. What type of students are entering your institute? What is the rank of the students in the test, national test or state level test? That also is an input to the program. And what is the output? Number of students graduating. How many students are passing out? 60 students entered 4 years back. How many have finally completed in 4 years? Is it 90%? It is 50%? It is 70%? Quantitative grades of students. What is the success performance index of the students? What is the average marks of the students? Success rate of students, what is the percentage of the students who are passing out? The outcome based assessment is knowledge, skill and behavior of a graduate is expected to attain. That is what knowledge, skill and attitude a graduate is expected to attain upon just completion of the program. That means when the program is just completed after just 4 years, then maybe after a few years, four or five years of passing out, what is the status? What is the behavior? What is the knowledge level? What is the skill level he has developed? Because if we have given him the exposure to learning to learn, self-learning, then probably in 4 or 5 years, he will be a much better engineer than what we produce in 4 years after just after passing out, right? After 4 or 5 years of graduation, observable and measurable abilities at outcomes, graduate attributes defined by NBA. This necessitates mapping of outcomes with graduate attributes, objectives, mission, and vision. You see, everything starts from the vision of the institute. Now, vision is a statement that what we want to do, where do we want to go. Mission is how to achieve that vision, right? Mission is how we want to achieve that vision. Then you work backwards to attain that vision and mission. You map your course curriculum, right? I want my student to be very good in mathematics. So have a mathematics in two three subjects, semesters. Have mathematics topic. Now, if you say my student will be very good in mathematics and you don't have mathematics subject after first year, How do you expect him? There are no mathematical problems given to him. There are no mathematical assignments. There are no mathematics in the tests. So there is a need for mapping of the outcomes with the graduate aptitudes, your curriculum, your labs, your theory, your teacher capabilities and qualifications. You need to map all of that. So it is a starting with a clear picture of what to do, what is important for the students to be able to do. That means my students should be able to do such and such after 4 years. My students should be able to be a very good air conditioning engineer. So that is my statement, what I want. Very broad statement. But how do I measure it? Whether he has become an air conditioning engineer or not. So, starting with a clear picture of what is important for students to be able to do, then organizing curriculum, delivery, and assessment to make sure learning happens. Make curriculum accordingly, make assessment tools accordingly, ensure learning process accordingly, so that what we have made the objectives, what we have planned, that is achieved. So it is basically a backward working. Start with what we want to do and then make the processes, map the things accordingly. So outcome-based education, what the student should be able to do? Map with the curriculum. Because unless we have it in the curriculum, students will not learn that. Outcome-based learning and teaching. How to make the student achieve that outcome? How you will make the teaching learning process so that the student learns, student is able to perform. Then how to measure what the student has achieved? How to measure the outcome? What are the tools you will be using? That leads to outcome-based education. So it is vision to make the vision. To meet the vision, you have the mission. From the mission, you have program educational objectives. These are the broader statements. To see whether the program educational objectives have been met or not, you have the program outcomes, which are measurable. These are smaller statements, which are measurable and very definite. You see, PEO can be broader, but PEOs are specific. Then you have courses. Courses means what the subjects we have and outcomes of the courses. Let's say I am teaching strength of material. Why am I teaching strength of material? I am teaching mathematics to the students. So what I expect the students do after going through the mathematics? I am teaching mathematics because I say dy by dx is the differentiation of the function. Why? Now why? Where is the applicability of this? Where will the student apply this equation? So what is the outcome of the course? That is very important. So course outcomes have to help in attainment of the program outcomes. Program outcomes will help in achievement of PEOs, program educational objectives, which in turn will help in attainment of the mission and vision of the institute. So everything starts from the top and comes to the bottom, and start from the bottom and goes to the top in attainment of the final vision of the institute. Now these are the graduate attributes. These are globally accepted attributes of the graduates, and these are generic. That means these are not discipline specific. It is not applicable to mechanical, electrical or civil only. It is to all disciplines. Engineering knowledge, applying knowledge of mathematics, science, engineering fundamentals and engineering specialization to the solution of complex engineering problems. That means after passing through my program of 4 years of degree program, the student should be able to apply knowledge of mathematics, basic sciences, engineering fundamentals, and an engineering specialization to to the solution of complex engineering problems. So that he can use everything what he has studied in 4 years to solution of complex engineering problems to give some new innovative solutions or innovative products to the society. Problem analysis, identify, formulate research literature and analyze complex engineering problems, reaching substantiated conclusions using first principles of mathematics, natural sciences and engineering sciences. That means he should be able to identify and formulate the problem. He should be able to identify and formulate the problem. You see, user will have a problem which he will give in general terms. So he should be able to, your engineering graduate should be able to translate that general terms into an engineering problem. He should be able to research the literature so that he can see what is available already, so that you don't restart doing everything. And analyze complex engineering problems, reaching substantiated conclusions. So he can come up with some good conclusion so that you are able to give a solution to the problem. Design development of solution, design solutions for complex engineering problems and design system components or processes that meet specific needs with appropriate consideration for public health and safety, culture, societal and environmental considerations. So it is very important here that you give a solution, you design a product, you give an engineering solution, but not without concern for public health and safety, culture, society and environmental. You should be able to take care of all these factors. You are not, your engineering graduates are not operating in isolation. They are part of the bigger system. So they have to see all these considerations, health and safety, culture, society, and environment. Conduct investigations of complex problems using research-based knowledge and research method, including design of experiments, analysis, and interpretation of data and synthesis of information to provide valid conclusions. Modern tool uses, create, select and apply appropriate technique sources and modern engineering and IT tools including prediction and modeling to complex engineering activities with an understanding of the limitation. That means it is not that the student will say, I have not studied computer so I cannot use computer. He should have the ability to learn new things, new technologies and apply those newly learned technologies to solution of his problem, because many things are there. Now, simulation is a very good tool. You can simulate things. Instead of making it physically, you can simulate the processes. Then, once you are satisfied, then you can go for prototyping. Because a lot of work simulation will do, then instead of making prototype and remaking the prototype, do it on simulated environment. Apply reasoning informed by contextual knowledge to assess societal health, safety, legal and cultural issues and the consequent responsibility relevant to professional engineering practice. Environment and sustainability. Understand the impact of professional engineering solutions in societal and environmental context and demonstrate knowledge of and need for sustainable development. You see, whatever you do, it should not harm the environment and it should be sustainable. Ethics, I think it is very important that your engineers should have some ethics. So apply ethical principle and commit to professional ethics and responsibilities and norms of engineering practices. Individual and teamwork, they should be able to work as a part of the team. They should be able to lead the team. They should be able to work individually also. So that type of capabilities we should be able to develop in our engineering graduate. Communication is very important. Unless you are able to communicate what you know, it is of no use, very little use. So communicate effectively on complex engineering activities with the engineering community and with society at large, such as being able to comprehend and write effective reports and design documentation, make effective presentation and give and receive clear instructions. One should be able to communicate effectively and he should be a good listener also. When somebody is telling something, he should listen also properly. He should not react without listening the other person. So develop those capabilities in the students. Lifelong learning, I have been stressing on it, that lifelong learning is very important, because things are very dynamic. It is not static, that what we have learned today, that will not suffice lifelong. Things are changing. So there has to be a capability, there has to be understanding, there has to be an appreciation of lifelong learning. That means recognize the need for and have the preparation and ability to engage in independent and lifelong learning in the broadest context of technological change. Technology is changing, things are changing, society is changing, human resource requirements are changing. So have that in mind when you are working. Project management and finance. Now you say, you cannot say I'm a technical person only. You have to have concern for finances. You have to concern for time bound thing. So how to manage the projects, how to manage the resources, how to manage the finances, everything. So demonstrate knowledge and understanding of engineering and managerial principles and apply these to one's own work as a member and leader in a team to manage projects and in multidisciplinary environment. Now it is not that a mechanical engineer or electrical engineer will work in his own department only. Now the system has changed, the demand has changed, the technology has changed. It is all multidisciplinary now. So the students, pass out, should have the capability to work on multidisciplinary areas, as either as a team, and he should have multidisciplinary basic skills also. So this is a summary of graduate attributes: engineering knowledge, problem analysis, design and development of solutions, investigation of complex problems, modern tool uses, engineers and society, environment and sustainability, ethics, individual and teamwork, communication, lifelong learning, and project management and finance, which we have discussed just now. Now, when you start filling the form for MBA, there are some terms which sometimes seem to be confusing. The form which you have to fill for applying to MBA is called SAR. This is self-assessment report. Why self-assessment? That means you fill the data and you can assess yourself also. Now, if you go to NBA website, there are a few forms available. They say, first is, there are different forms for UG, different forms for PG, and different forms for diploma, polytechnic level institution. And under each category, there are two, tier 1 and tier 2 forms. Now, tier 1 is basically for universities and university constituent colleges, which have control over their curriculum. Tier 2 is for other colleges which are affiliated to university. There is no control on the curriculum. The curriculum is made by university and given to the colleges, and they have to implement it. So the colleges which are affiliated to a university for their program, they have to use Tier 2 program, Tier 2 performer. Now there is some terms which NBA has given. Course. Course is a unit of teaching which encompasses various topics that typically last one semester, is led by one or more faculty, and has a fixed register students. That means, in loose terms, what we call it as a subject, right? That is a course on strength of materials, course on computer programming, right? Program is comprehensive arrangement of courses, co-curricular and extracurricular activities to accomplish predetermined objectives leading to the award of a degree. So program is like undergraduate program in engineering or BTech in engineering, BTech in mechanical engineering. So what should it comprise? It should comprise such subjects, such co-curricular activities and extracurricular activities, and your study and evaluation scheme, how this will be, how many hours you want to devote to each subject in a week, how it will be evaluated. So that becomes a program. And degree is an academic award conferred upon a student on successful completion of a program designed to achieve the defined attributes. Right? Another term what we use is, sometimes it has a department. Now department is an administrative setup, mechanical engineering department, computer science department. Now, computer science department may be offering two programs. One is in computer science and engineering, one is in IT. So, program is BTech IT, BTech computer science and engineering, whereas department is computer science, right? So, that is the difference. Now, as we start, I said that the everything starts from the vision. Vision is a futuristic statement that the institution department would like to achieve over a long period of time. If you see it, read carefully, vision is a futuristic statement that the institution of league department. That means institution will have a vision and the department will also have a vision. But department vision cannot be different from the institute vision. So department vision should go towards the institution vision only. It should assist in attainment of the institution vision. And mission statements are essentially the means to achieve the vision. For example, vision create high quality engineering professionals, or let's say in mechanical engineering, create high quality mechanical engineering professionals. Right? The institute vision is create high quality engineering professionals. How do I do it? That is given a mission statement. Mission statement is offer a well-balanced program of instruction, practical experience, and opportunities for overall personality development to achieve the vision, which is create high quality engineering professionals. So that the institute will do such and such, which is given in the mission, to achieve the vision of the institute. Now, what are PEOs? Program educational objectives are broad statements that describe the career and professional accomplishments that the program is preparing the graduates to achieve. That means what the graduates, after going through the program, will be able to achieve. It goes towards the graduate attributes. It has to come from that, because it says my graduate students will be able to apply mathematics, science, and basic engineering and discipline specific knowledge to the solution of complex engineering problems. Right? So all your POs are directed towards what? A to K graduate attributes. When you start writing, you see, you have to write the PEOs. When you start applying, when you think of applying for accreditation, you have to write the PEOs and POs for all the programs, for all the courses. I was talking about SAR. I'll come back to it. So once you have selected that, you will go for tier 1 or tier 2 SAR type of performer. You can download it and fill it. Now, NBA now encourages applying on online, that they call it ENBA. So go to their site. First, you have to register your institute on the website. Like AICT gives you a permanent ID, NBA will also give you a permanent ID and password. Then you can fill your information online. Now, guidelines for the PEOs. PEOs should be consistent with the mission of the institution. That is what I have been telling. Number of PEOs should be manageable. That means it should be achievable. It should not write anything which is not achievable. PEO should be achievable by the program. PEO should be specific to the program and not too broad. Right? It should be pointing to the program. Specific to the program. PEO should be based on the needs of the constituency. That means, who are the likely users of the output of your system? Industry is the user. Industry is one of the stakeholders. Society is another. So, are they contributing something to the society and industry? So, it should be directed towards that. Now, how to develop the PEOs? NBA says that you have a meeting You have consultation with industry, alumni, students, management, professional bodies, faculty, parents. Some data on future from the literature, data on trends in development in the profession. Get the views, get their views. It is not necessary that you will take care of all the views of all the stakeholders. No, you say summarize the views, then take out the accepted views which are common and which you feel are feasible and justifiable. Identification and designing of the courses with defined objectives. You see, accepted views will give you some objectives, right? Let's say mechanical engineer will do design of machine components. It is accepted view. Now, that means my mechanical engineering should be able to design mechanical equipment, right? That is one of my objectives. Now, from this objectives, what I will do? I will draw the subjects. What are the subjects I need to teach for this? I should teach him basic drawing. I should teach him machine design. I should teach him engineering materials. I should teach him strength of material. I should teach him theory of machines also, isn't it? So you draw the subjects. Start working backwards. So from the accepted views, have objectives, identification and designing of courses with defined objectives. To meet those objectives, you have the subject and courses. Some of them will be core courses, some of them will be elective courses, which you can, where you can go in for some specializations. Let's say I have taught machine design. Now one person goes for machine design of manufacturing equipment, others want to go for thermal power. So have a specification, have a specialization in thermal power, right? Some people want to in software development, some want to go for software testing. Give them the opportunity, right? Some people want to go to for mechatronics, give them the opportunity. Now comes the program outcomes. Program outcomes are narrower statements. Program PEOs were the broader statements that my students will be very good design engineer. PEO program outcomes are narrower statements that describe what students are expected to know and be able to do by the time of graduation. So program outcomes basically describe knowledge, skill and behavior of the students as they progress through the program as well as by the time of graduations. PEOs should not be too broad. PEOs must align with the graduate attributes. They must reflect all the graduate attributes. Unless you are able to measure whether some graduate attribute has been achieved or not, let's say I come to the first graduate attribute, apply knowledge of mathematics to engineering problems. So I should have some tools to measure whether my student after graduation is able to apply the mathematics to engineering problems, right? Am I giving some problem, koi design problem diya humne usko ki jisse hum check karke mathematics lagta hai usme. So we should have POs very well defined so that we can measure, we can test him whether he has achieved the required outcome or not. Now these are the course outcomes. First line is very interesting. It says it should be student focused, not professor focused. What is the meaning? That means the learning, not the coverage oriented. Students should learn. It is not that the professor wants to cover the syllabus. Okay, मैंने तो syllabus कर दिया, मेरा काम खत्म हो गया. Whether the students are has learned or not, that is not my concern. No, it is student centered, not the teacher centered. Alignment between course, program and institution level. The course outcomes need to reflect both the objectives and outcomes that the academic program represents as well as the broader mission of the institution as a whole. As I said, it has to go backwards from course to the program, to the department, to the institute. Focus on abilities central to this discipline. Course outcomes should help prepare students for what is important to the discipline of the which the course is a part. That means when I am teaching computer programming to a mechanical engineer, I should be able to relate my mechanical engineering with the computer. How computer can be used in mechanical engineering? What happens? When computer is taught to a mechanical engineer, he is also taught how to solve a quadratic equation. Agreed. Where will he use it? Tell him that. Right? He is told to write a program on how to calculate the interest on a simple or compound interest basis. Tell him some mechanical engineering program, how you can draw a shear force and bending moment diagram with that. How can you can find the reactions of a simply supported beam? If we can relate the teaching to the central theme of the program, it helps the students and it helps in the teaching of the subject also. Focus on aspects of learning that will endure. Teaching students new models of thinking is likely to have an impact on their future. Having them memorize facts tends to be much more short-lived. You see, they रट्टा लगा लेंगे एक बार तो ठीक है पर भूल जाएंगे थोड़ी देर बाद. If they are application based, new technology based, so they will try to remember. Course outcomes are limited to manageable number. मतलब बहुत ज्यादा course outcomes भी ना करो जो आप manage ही ना हो सके. Specific enough to be measurable. That means course outcomes should be वेरी स्पेसिफिक, जिनको हम किसी तरह से मेजर कर सकें. उसकी मेजरमेंट टेक्निक भी हमें बतानी पड़ेगी. क्या करेंगे हम उसके लिए? क्विज लेंगे, उसके लिए प्रोजेक्ट देंगे, उसके लिए हम असाइनमेंट देंगे, या उसके लिए क्लास टेस्ट लेंगे, या मिड टर्म टेस्ट लेंगे. क्या है उसके लिए? हाउ टू मेजर दैट आउटकम? Program specific criteria. Program criteria provide the specificity needed for interpretation of the bachelor level criteria as applicable to a given discipline. Program criteria provide the specificity needed for interpretation of the bachelor level criteria as applicable to the given discipline. That means it is very specific to a particular program. Requirements stipulated in the program criteria are limited to the areas of curriculum topics and faculty qualification expertise. That means it is whatever you are writing the requirements, that is for a particular program. Whatever expertise you want for the faculty, that is for the particular program. Now he has given an example also that CSC must include probability and statistics, discrete mathematics, such and such subjects. Necessary to analyze software and system containing hardware and software components. If you read this, similarly, mechanical engineering must include principles of engineering, basic sciences and mathematics, including multivariable calculus and differential equations to model, analyze, design and realize physical systems, components or processes, and prepare students to work professionally in both thermal and mechanical system areas. So it is very specific. Specific to mechanical, specific to computer science. One of the points NBA asks is, where are these PEOs, POs, and course objectives, course outcomes listed? How the students know, how the faculty know, how the parents know that these are the PEOs, POs, and course outcomes? So it says, awareness to all stakeholders on defined vision and mission, that is PEOs, vision and mission, PEOs, POs and CEOs, publishing on the website, curricula books, display boards, etc. Awareness workshop to students and faculty periodically. That means you should make the students and faculty aware that is what we want out of the program. It is not passing the examination. It is developing the required knowledge and skills. Prepare stakeholders to reinforce with the activities vis-a-vis achievement of the vision and mission, PEOs and PEOs, POs and CEOs. That means whatever activities we are doing, they should contribute to, how they will contribute to the achievement of vision and mission, that should be reinforced. this is how the system works. We start from here, mission and vision. To achieve that mission and vision, these are the PEOs, program educational objectives. From program educational objectives, to meet those program educational objectives, you come to PEOs, program outcomes, which are guided by graduate attributes, which I discussed. And to meet these PEOs, you have course outcomes. So from course outcomes, you get PEOs, which are guided by GAs, and from PEOs, the PEOs help in the attainment of PEOs, which help in the attainment of the meeting the mission of the institute. Now, these are the 9 criteria on which accreditation is done. Vision, mission, and program educational objectives. This is one criteria. This is the latest criteria which is available. Program outcomes, program curriculum, student performance in the program, faculty contributions, facilities and technical support, academic support units and teaching learning process, governance, institutional support and financial resources, continuous improvement. We have talked on vision, mission, and program educational objectives. That means it should be very well defined. Program outcomes, we have talked what are program outcomes, and they should contribute to the attainment of PEOs. Program curriculum should be such that, again, it helps in attainment of PEOs. It should be very well defined and it should be mapped. There should be mapping of the program curriculum with the PEOs. That means this subject, I have a subject on mathematics, let's say numerical methods in engineering, which contributes to meeting the first PEO, which says my students will be able to apply engineering knowledge in solution of mathematics knowledge in solution of engineering problems. So it says that, okay, curriculum is a subject of mathematics, it helps in attainment of this PEO. Or program outcome hai. Program outcome se hum kya measure kar rahe hain, usse hum kaun se PEO ko contribute kar rahe hain, ya kaun sa subject kis PEO ko contribute kar raha hai. Students performance in the program, how the students are performing, how many students are passing. Let's say you started with 60 students, how many have passed in 4 years, taken the degree in 4 years, or what is the pass percentage from first year to second year to third year. What is the quality of students you are getting? What is the rank of the students you are getting for admission in your institute? Are there good students below 20,000, 30,000 in, let's say, national level examination? Or you get very, very low rank students? Faculty contribution. Here, everything is covered. Faculty qualifications, faculty numbers, faculty cater ratio, faculty publications, faculty training, faculty involvement in other activities. So everything is covered in, about the faculty, it is covered in number 5. Facilities and technical support, here your labs. What are type of labs, whether there are enough labs, there are enough labs in the department to meet the curriculum requirement. What is the type of equipment there? What is the condition of the equipment there? Do you have enough money for the consumables? Have you set up any new facilities in the last 2-3 years? Do you have enough technical manpower to support the labs? Are the faculty and technical staff sent for upgradation of qualification or for attending training programs? Academic support units and teaching learning process. Do you have academic support units? Do you have a TPO? Do you have, what are the teaching learning processes you have? Do the teachers maintain a course file? Do the teachers conduct tests in time? Do the teachers give the evaluated answer sheets to the students in time? All that's there. Governance, institutional support, and financial resources. Do you have a, does the institute have a BOG constituted as per AICT guidelines? Does the institute have hostel? Does it have internet? Does it have transport? Are the board of governors meetings held regularly? Are there enough finances available? Are the finances allocated to the departments for recurring and non-recurring expenditure? Are the revenue and expenditure statements available to the general public, at least the stakeholders, parents, students? Then last point is continuous improvement. Continuous improvement says that what is the improvement in the last 3 years in your pass percentage, that means student performance, in your placement, in your faculty qualification, in your faculty contribution to R&D. Continuous improvement in the last 3 years or and continuous improvement from the last assessment when it was accredited. Maybe the committee has given some report, some weak points and some strong points of the institute. What is the action on that and what is the improvement in that? If it is not accredited earlier, this is the first time the institute is going for accreditation. Since it was set up, what is the improvement? So these are the 9 points on which accreditation is done. Normally when you apply for accreditation to the to NBA, NBA will constitute a team of academicians. The maximum you can apply for is 5 programs at a time. Many people have been asking me what is the fee for applying to NBA for accreditation. Now, the latest figures I'll give you is that when you register at NBA site, you have to give the 1 lakh rupees as registration fee to NBA. Then if you want to apply for 1 program, the fee is 4 lakhs. If you want to apply for 2 programs, it is 5.5 lakhs. That means minimum is 4 lakhs. Then for each program, you keep on adding 1.5 lakhs. So for 2 programs, it is 5.5, 3 programs, it is 7, 4 programs, it is 8.5, and 5 programs, it is 2 lakhs. After you have paid the fee to NBA, you don't have to do anything. All the transport arrangements, all the stay arrangements of the NBA team are made by NBA. You don't have to worry about the logistics, their transportation, their stay. Everything is done by NBA. The visit is of 3 days for multiple programs. And if it is a single program, let's say somebody wants to get a single program only accredited, it is 2 days. It is a 3 days visit, which is virtually reduces to 2 days, because on the third day, there is only 1 meeting, that is called exit meeting with the management, where the team interacts with the management and tells them their strong and weak points, and an opportunity is given to the management for withdrawal of the program. That means if they feel that their impression from the interaction with the team is that this program may not be approved for accreditation, they can withdraw that program from accreditation. During the visit, in the first 2 days, there is a visit to center facilities, there is a visit to the department, there are meetings with the students, there are meetings with the faculty, there are meetings with the supporting staff, there are meetings with alumni, there is a meeting with parents, and there is a meeting with the employers. to just see the feedback they have about their students, about your college and the students. So this is what happens during the NBA, and these are the 9 criteria. All these criteria, this is available, all these criteria are available on the NBA website. You can download and go through. So I'll stop here, and we can go for questions, if any. Yes, we can go have questions. I can have questions, please. TTC Jodhpur. Yes, please.
No question, sir.
IIT Badal. No question, thank you. IIT Badal.
No question, sir.
Okay. And Jaipur Center, please. Jaipur Center, any questions, please? SKPC.
Yes, sir.
Any questions, please?
Just hold, sir.
Anyone want to ask something? Hello? Anyone want to ask something, question from NITTR?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you. Then we close here. We will meet again at 2 o'clock, please. Thank you.